सफर दर वतन, जर्नी होमवर्ड्स। दिस इज फोर्थ कलमा ऑफ द सूफीज एज अ गाइडलाइन फॉर द सीकर्स। दीज कलमास हैव बीन गिवन बाय हजरत इब्न खालिद किस्तवानी रज़ी अल्लाह ताला अन्हु फॉर द सीकर्स अलोंग द पाथ, सो दैट दे कैन मेंटेन देयर अवेयरनेस and do not get wavered. Safar means journey or travel. Dar is a connecting word. Watan means your homeland or the country. What is the Sufi understanding of Watan? What is your Watan is not the country of your birth, is not the country of your domicile, is not the country of your residence. No, certainly Sufi masters do not accept that as your watan. It means to travel to one's homeland. It means to travel to one's homeland. What is really meant by homeland? Is it your home or the country? No, it is indeed. Yes, indeed, it refers to the homeland. But the homeland is not what you understand by the word. This is the problem with the masters. They have to use your language, and what they in fact want to communicate cannot be put into words. By homeland, the master means the inner space, the space of harmony, the space of oneness, the space of bliss, the space where there is no conflict or no warland. That particular space in Christianity is known as sacred heart. Sufis call this as qalb. By homeland, the master means your inner space, a space that is your being and represents the existence within you, represents the presence of God in whatever form you call Him within you. So this is inward journey. It means that the seeker travels from the world of creation, the world of duality, the world of conflict, the world of being and object to inward. The travelers moves from the outer world to inner, from the world of duality, the world of objects and beings, to the world of the creator, or your inner world of being. It is the world of bliss, it is the world of serenity, it is the realm of meditation. Sufis say that Holy Prophet Hazrat Paighambar Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, I am going to my Lord from one state to a better state and from one station to a higher one. It is said that the seeker must travel from the desire for the forbidden to the desire for the divine presence. In Islamic tradition, this transcendence of desire from the forbidden land to the divine presence is considered as the way. Whereas desire whether for the forbidden land or for the divine presence is desire. In reality, we cannot use the word desire. The problem is there is no better word to explain to that. Because of this word desire that we use, we have to give further explanations. Desire for the forbidden to the desire for the divine presence. I would simply say, it is said that the seeker must travel from his connections to the forbidden, to the divine presence. A journey from the forbidden aspect of life to the life that is soaked in divine presence. You operate in the world of duality or the world of objects and beings. Numerous stimuli or impressions reach your mind. It is like a child walking through a toy store. Any toy he sees, he wants that. And then when he moves to another store, immediately forgets all about toys. He wants something else. This is how we continue to move in the world of objects and beings. As if every moment we are walking through the aisles of a department store, a big department store, where there are attractions on either side of us. And as we walk and our eyes catch a glance of a particular object or being, we are attracted to that. No sooner that we move to another object or that object catches our glance, the focus moves from the first object to the second. Remain indecisive. This is how we continue to move in the world of objects and beings. The inward journey implies the attention has to move from outer to the inner world of serenity, bliss, and harmony. Sometimes practice this. This is a part of the meditation. As a part of a living being, we must walk through the aisles of the supermarkets, department stores, shopping malls. You will remain in your inner thoughts. Suppose at that time you are in the thoughts of your beloved who has left to go to some other place for a couple of days. You are missing her. You are thinking of her. While thinking of her, you may walk through the aisles, nothing will attract you because you are lost to the thoughts of your beloved. When this thing can happen, in case of the worldly love, why we can't have the same intensity of love for our inner life, for bliss and harmony? You will observe that you will not notice anything. As a part of my living and the activity of business that I have to undergo, I have to walk through the aisles of the supermarkets. Some of the supermarkets have a section like a department store where many things other than the food items are also sold. My purpose is to visit the store, check our shelves, merchandise these so that all our products are displayed properly, take the order and come back home to our warehouse, take out the goods and deliver it. Not only deliver, we have to arrange it on our shelves. In 99.9% cases, I see only those objects which I have to merchandise, market or supply. Other things remain invisible to me, just as when a teacher who was teaching archery to the students, there was a competition, a bird was placed on top of the tree on a branch And the teacher asks the students, what do you see? One by one, each one of them said, I see everything, the tree, you, all the other competitors. So as the person said that, he was put aside that you are not ready as yet. When chance came for one of the archers, he asked, what do you see? He said, I see the eye of the bird. Don't you see anything else? No, I don't see anything else. My target is the bull's eye, the iris of the bird that I have to pierce through. Such kind of understanding has to be there. In Japan, they teach archery as a part of meditation. You will find it strange how archery could be a meditation. Anything can become a meditation. It all depends on your approach and attitude. When you are single pointed to your target and nothing else, like the master said that you have to pierce through the eye of the bird, and that too a particular part of the eyes, not the two eyes but only one specific eye, very precise. That the space that he has to pierce through is very precise. And when that alone is visible to you, you are ready in the process of archery. Such should be the situation of a seeker, that you don't see anything else. You may be walking through the aisles, but I am so much lost, so much absorbed in the love of my beloved that nothing appeals to me. Nothing is visible to me except the remembrance, the thoughts, the countenance of my beloved. Ek baar jo tune pukara tha mujhe, taaziz mere man mein basti rahi shehnai. Once you had called me lovingly, that sound continues to echo in my ears ever long. Such is the situation of a seeker. Once you had called me lovingly, the echo, the sound of that continues to echo in my ears ever long. Since then, no other sound appeals to me, no other countenance remains in front of my eyes or attracts me anymore. Inward journey implies this kind of attention, this kind of focus, and nothing else but the thought, the countenance. Anything that you see must remind you of your beloved. It is said of one of the Sufi masters, Hazrat Maulana Abdul Ghani Khan Razi Allah Ta'ala, I happened to be in his company. One person came to him, and he was ordinary person, but he had love for the Sheikh. He wanted to have a dialogue with him. So while the dialogue was going on, he continued. The time came for the evening prayers. He said, Hazrat, it is time for prayers, and it is incumbent on every Muhammadan to offer salah or the prayer. He said, sure, you must go and offer the prayer. But he said that I would like to offer the prayer today behind you. He said, I don't need to go to the mosque. I will offer my prayer right here. So it be, the man said. The prayer mats were spread. Hazrat Shah Abdul Ghani Khan Razi Allah Ta'ala Unhu was in front as a Pesh Imam. Means this comes from the two words Pesh and Imam. Imam is the Muslim priest, and Pesh means one who offers all the followers in prayer to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala or at the altar is known as Pesh Imam. So when the first Shajda took place, his head was on the floor and he remained in that state for 45 minutes. When he woke up, second, third and subsequent Shajdas were performed. The prayer finished in nearly hour and a half. The man said, "Hazrat, I have never seen such a prayer. Namaz takes maybe maximum 10 minutes, but this were hour and a half." He said, "When I finished the first sajda, while I was doing it, I saw a dog passed, and this dog reminded me of the dog that my Shaykh had. And that particular dog or the situation threw me in the company of my master. The company of my master is more important than the prayer that is considered to be incumbent on a Muslim. And it is because of that you had to remain in that position for 45 minutes while you walk through the aisles of the busy marketplace amidst the objects and beings. Something or the other must remind you of your beloved. Maybe how you and your beloved holding the hands walked through this aisle and had something at that particular shop. You will forget everything else and only the remembrance of that presence of your beloved, that company will be. This is the way to understand Safar Darwatan." Naqshbandi Sufi masters divide this travel or inward journey into two categories. The first is external journey and the second is internal one. External travel is to movements from one land to another, seeking a perfect guide along the path to take and direct you to your destination. This cannot happen on your own. As such as you are, you cannot seek a perfect master. And even if you succeed in seeking a perfect master, he will in turn seek a perfect disciple as well. It is right for you to seek a perfect master, but it is not for the master seeking a perfect disciple. When you say you are seeking a perfect master, this is a function of ego. What criteria do you have to seek a perfect master? In the examination, you write the answers to the questions in the question paper. It is the expert who is an expert in that field judges your answers and gives the marks accordingly. You are not a master, you have not attained to any state. What criteria do you have? Are you going with the criteria set in the books? And you are doing your own interpretations of that. The master should look like this, he should talk like this, he should walk like this. These are all outer symptoms. A master lives in his inner world. Ego always seeks perfection. What is in fact needed is your inner preparation. It is your disciplehood that will bring a master to you. Sufis say master appears the moment disciple is ready. The moment disciple is born in you, master appears. This enables you to move to the second category, the internal journey. Seekers, once they have found a perfect guide, are forbidden to go on another external journey. In the external journey, there are many difficulties which beginners cannot endure without falling into the forbidden actions. Because they are weak in their worship, in their consciousness, in their awareness and understanding, so there is every possibility that they may falter. It is said when you are speaking to a person of the opposite sex, you should never look into the eyes of the person. Because all that a person has to say is communicated through the eyes. If you continue to look at the feet of the person, there is very less possibility of faltering. Now begins the second stage. The second stage or the category is internal journey. Internal journey requires the seeker to leave his low manners and move to the higher ones, to throw out of his heart all worldly desires. He will be lifted from a state of uncleanliness to a state of purity. Journey from duality towards unity or oneness begins. At that time, he will no longer be in the need of more internal journey. He will have a sanctified and enchanted heart that is pure and flowing like water, transparent like crystal, precious like a gem, and polished like a mirror too, reflecting the inner qualities in the outer world of interaction. He will then be in the world, but the world will not be within him. No more his actions will be a bondage unto him. In his heart, will appear everything that is needed for his life and for the life of those around him. This is the way one has to attain to this state of Safar Darwatan. Safar Darwatan. This is the next kalma is Khilwat Dar Anjuman.